Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Stir up your power, O Lord, and with great might come among us. And because we are sorely hindered by our sins, let your bountiful grace and mercy speedily help and deliver us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory now and forever.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty on the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its root, its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. The word of the Lord. A reading from the first lesson of Paul to the Thessalonians. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit, do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The Gospel of the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus, be near to the brokenhearted and save those whose spirits are crushed. Amen. It was in the early days of open heart surgery, when those bypass procedures were still very innovative and very new and very awe-inspiring and a little bit frightening. As a very young student chaplain, I was assigned to visit someone the night before his open heart surgery, and I went into the room imagining all of the concerns that he might be bringing to this moment, all the anxiety or fear or worry that might be stirring in him. And so I was more than a little bit surprised to discover that his greatest concern that he was able to express did not have anything to do with what I suspected. He opened up his hospital gown, showed me the perfect tattoo covering his entire chest of Amelia Earhart, and said that his greatest concern was that the surgeons would sew it back together perfectly. It seems like a kind of silly story. And yet underneath that, I think that man was, as we all do, yearning for things to be put right, to be healed from the inside out, for things to be back in order, just exactly how they should be, for things to be reconnected and made whole. The people who first heard the words from the prophet Isaiah, which we hear this morning, were people who were also yearning for things to be restored and put back together and made the way they had been. Returning from exile, they had hoped to rebuild Jerusalem to its former glory. Even though some of them had never seen that and had only heard about it as the generations had passed along, they had returned home and were disappointed at how difficult it was and how far short they fell of their great vision of restoration. They were mourning and wondering why it was that they couldn't put it all just right again. Scholars for generations have wondered whether these words from Isaiah were addressed to an individual, to a community of people, or to the whole people of Israel. And Christians have taken these words to apply particularly to Jesus, as we have heard him in Luke's gospel invoke this very passage as he begins to speak about his mission in the world and proclaims to the people that today these words have been fulfilled in their hearing. The whole range of possible ways of hearing and understanding and contextualizing these words from Isaiah allow us, perhaps in that ambiguity, to hear these words as words both of comfort to us and of call to us. And particularly to look at and sit with one phrase from this beautiful poetry of Isaiah, to bind up the brokenhearted. Heartbroken is not a word that I have frequently seen in headlines until recently, and it seems to appear more and more as a description of people and communities and our nation and our world in this particular time. We are aware of that heartbreak, the sadness, the burden of grief, and we are aware of brokenness as well. Each of us knows that heartbreaking loss that we experience now, whether it's in seemingly small but very significant things in our own lives, or in the staggering, overwhelming, burdensome numbers that we hear day to day as the deaths from this pandemic continue to mount. We know that sense of loss, and we live with it and in it, and we look for words of comfort and strength as we try to pace ourselves and to endure to the end of this time, even as we see the possible light of that ending. We resonate and look for comfort in the face of this brokenhearted world. Beyond that, though, we also see the brokenness that has endured for generations, the devastation that has been there, the people whose lives have been broken and whose hearts have been heavy with the weight of oppression and discrimination, with the injustice of the world, with things that are beyond their control and yet limit and constrain their life, their energy, their spirit by the human limits which have been set for them. So we listen to these words both as comfort, comfort to us and to the whole world in a time of loss and heartbreak. We listen to these words as words of call, as we imagine how we can touch other individuals who are knowing this time of loss, to strengthen them, to touch them, to draw close to them and surround them with love in the face of things that are hard to bear. And also the call to look at our world now and as we move into the future, looking for ways to be the people of God who respond to these beautiful, visionary, dreaming promises expressed by Isaiah, that will allow the brokenness of our world to be knit back together, restored, put right, made in the glory that it was meant to be, the wonderful binding together of humanity in the place of brokenness. In this Advent season, we point to the light and bear witness to it. We prepare the way of the Lord and try to make a straight path for that coming. The one we wait for, the one we long for, the one we open our arms to welcome, comes to us bound and wrapped in swaddling clothes, in bands of cloth, as a baby held by his parents. The one we wait for and long for comes to us bound to all of us in our broken humanity, willing to take near to him and to enter into all of the fullness of our human existence with its joy and its sorrow. The one we wait for is bound to us in a way that allows for the binding up of all the brokenhearted. As we watch and wait and welcome him, may we also join in the work of healing and wrapping the world for the healing purposes of God. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Let us pray that Emmanuel will come to us, saying, "Come and save us." For the Church, for the grace to pray without ceasing and to hold fast to what is good, for the gifts of joy and gratitude in all circumstances, for our witness to the light of Christ. God of peace, show us your faithfulness. Come, O come, Emmanuel, come and save us. For all the people of the world, for the restoration of ruined cities and devastated places, for people who are in prison, for those who love justice and resist oppression, for a way through the divisions and mistrust in our nation. For everyone who has grown weary in the pandemic. For public health officials planning for the distribution of vaccines. For those who serve our country, particularly Christine, Logan, Wade, and Trace and his shipmates. For their families and for the safe return of those far from home. Bind up the brokenhearted and proclaim liberty to the captives. Come, O come, Emmanuel.
Come and save us.
For all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. For Elise, Diane, Benjamin, Bob, Anna, Kathleen, Bev, Conroy, Henry, Tim, Larry, Luke, Jean, Bob, James, Allison, John, Bob, Erica, Ming, Nancy, Michael, Carolyn, Diane, Megan, Marion, Laura, Mark, Cynthia, and all those who have been commended to our prayers. For the people infected with COVID-19 and for their loved ones. For hospitals, nursing facilities, physicians, nurses, lab technicians, and other workers experiencing the strain of increased COVID cases. For people throughout the world living with HIV and AIDS. For those struggling with addiction and those in recovery. For caregivers. For those whom we now name. Let their weeping be turned into songs of joy. Come, O come, Emmanuel. Come and save us. For those who have died, for Connie Combs, James Knox, G. William Bissell, Sue Neff, and Frederick Schult, for those in whose memory altar flowers are given today, Lawrence Eames, Norman Ernst, Fletcher Hodges Jr., Sarah Margaret Hodges, and Josh Rispoli. For people who have died from COVID-19 and for those who grieve for them. For victims of gun violence and for those whom we now remember. Clothe them with the garments of salvation and comfort those who mourn. Come, O come, Emmanuel.
Come and save us. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Welcome to Calvary Episcopal Church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, on this third Sunday of the Advent season. We have several announcements, and they are all in the printed bulletin and available on the front of Calvary's webpage. Upcoming on Sunday, December 20th, next week, the Christmas pageant will be online. It will be all virtual. There will be camels and other animals in this pageant as usual. This Tuesday evening is an Advent meditation by the Reverend Leslie Reimer that will be available online. Christmas Eve, the service is at 4:00, and Christmas Day at 9:30. And another event also next Sunday at 5 p.m. is Christmas Lessons and Carols. It's a wonderful service, very similar to Advent, different readings, and even more familiar carols for you to sing along to at home. On Sunday, January 3rd, we will observe the 100th anniversary of the first worship service that was broadcast on radio. That happened here at Calvary Church on January 2, 1921. And on that day, Sunday, January 3rd, I'll tell the story about that. And Alan has arranged that we will do some of the music that we did 100 years ago. We'll do this upcoming January. Beginning on Sunday, January 10th, we will begin a new discipleship class. That's for all those interested in the Episcopal Church, are learning more about our generous approach to the Christian faith, and it may also lead to confirmation, that is, how to become a confirmed Episcopalian in this tradition. This class is for adults only, and it will be online beginning again January 10th. Thank you to all those who made a financial pledge to support the mission of Calvary Church. If you would like to join them, we certainly invite you to do so and appreciate your generosity. If you would like to give as a single event, there is a little button. Live is the live service, and give is right next to that in the top right corner of our webpage. Again, thank you for your generosity. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, and offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people, and your words spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer a sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, O Father Almighty, world without end. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in my heart in the fullness of your strength. Be my wisdom and guide me in right pathways. Conform my life and actions to the image of your holiness and in the power of your gracious might. Rule over every hostile power that threatens or disturbs the growth of your kingdom, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you, as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge of love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.